Шановні студенти, шановні гості, distinguished guest students, we are continuing the series of educational lectures, art as the instrument of national branding, in which we are going to present experts' performances, round tables, and master classes in perspective. Therefore, we decide to come over to the educational part of our program along with the holding the exhibitions. Taking into account the importance of strengthening the image of Ukraine in the world, today we are going to hear again how countries' images are formed by the right positioning of artistic masterpieces. First of all, I'd like to present and introduce our guest, James Butterwick. You can see him. A world-class modern art expert and avant-garde and impressionism guru. Distinguished British politicians, members of the House of Lords, Lord Risby, who is the chairman and director of the British Ukrainian Society, and Sir Gerard Hobart, who chairs the all-party parliamentary group on Ukraine in the UK Parliament. Before we start, let me tell you a few words about James Butterwick. He is a famous London collector, a respected specialist in modern art, one of the few specialists in Ukraine art in the West. He has a long-term experience in the recognition of art forgery, and since 1990s he has been giving lectures around the world. This year, James is the only one who presented the paintings by the famous Ukrainian painter Alexander Bogomazov at the greatest antique fair in Europe, TIFAF in Maastricht. Moreover, it was the first personal exhibition by Bogomazov in the West. Now I'd like to give the floor to James Butterwick, who will go in more details on the subject. Please, James.
Thank you very much, Valera. I'm going to talk today about an artist who should represent all of you. He is, without question, the greatest Ukrainian artist. 1880 to 1930, Alexander Bogomazov. For those of you who were at the last lecture given by my extremely erudite and intelligent friend, Guy, we were talking about the art as a brand, the brand as art. What I propose to tell you today is about how Bogomazov can become the Ukrainian brand, the brand artist. My lecture will be a little bit different from Guy's. First of all, if you remember, Guy talked about Yekaterina Belakour as being the representative of Ukraine, that she's the artist who probably the West knows in the, about, sorry, the Ukrainian artist about which the West knows most. While I was flying out here 2 days ago, there was Panorama, the Air Ukraine magazine, and there we had an article on Maria Primachenka, who is probably known to most of you. I think Katya Bilakur and Primachenka, two artists known to most Ukrainians. That's an example of Primachenka's work. Bilakur we've already seen. Now this is the classic example of where East meets West. Bilakur and Primachenka are clearly Eastern-looking artists. I'm going to show you an artist who is not Eastern-looking, he's Western-looking. He's a Western artist. He's a Western artist in the quality of his work and of his vision. Okay, the Ukrainian Picasso, Alexander Bogomazov. He was so called because somebody in the visitor's book in 1966, at the first exhibition of Bogomazov ever in Kiev at the Union of Writers, wrote in the visitor's book, Ukrainsky Picasso, so the Ukrainian Picasso. That's how he got his name. Okay, there's a little house in Kiev. There it is. It's on Vznesensky Spusk. Very small, modest little house. And there lived Bogomazov. And we know because here is his memorial tablet outside. Now, I lived in this house, as you can see, for 16 years, post his marriage to Vanda. So he is a known artist. Now, the remarkable thing about Bogomazov is, I say he's Western looking, he is Western looking. He never went to the West, not once. He went to Helsinki in 1911. He was sent there by Kievsky and Wiesel. He went to Moscow in 1907 to 1908, where he studied in the studios of Weberg and Yuon. And then finally, in 1915, he went to Armenia. Now, those are the only three times that Bogomazov left Ukraine. So we're going to be discussing, is Bogomazov a Ukrainian? He is a Ukrainian. These are the only three occasions where he left his beloved Kiev. Now, how did he know about Western art? Purely through publications, all right? So all the Western tendencies of the days, your Picassos, your Ballas, your Boccionis, your Legers, and so on, he only knew about these artists through publications that were brought to him by another Kiev artist called Alexander Ekster. Is Bogomazov Ukrainian? Key question, okay? 1880 to 1906, the first 26 years of his life, Bogomazov was in Ukraine. He wasn't anywhere else. He was in where he was born, which is Yampol in Kharkovsk Oblast. He studied in Kiev. He studied in Kherson. And in 1905, he went to the Crimea. He never went anywhere else. You have to remember with Bogomazov, he was permanently impecunious. He was permanently broke. He had no money. His father disowned him. His mother walked out on him when he was a child. So this is a man with a tragic history as well. Kiev is his city. Kiev is the city of Bogomazov. Bogomazov is the diarist of Kiev. So who is Bogomazov? Right, 1991 was kind of the key year as far as the PR relating to Bogomazov is concerned. Two exhibitions, one in Toulouse and one in the National Museum in Kiev. These were the two first proper personal exhibitions devoted to this artist. There had been an exhibition in 1966, as we saw earlier, but that was very much an underground exhibition. The exhibition had a serious resonance because a lot of people got into quite a lot of trouble for doing this exhibition, as you'll see why later on. Now, this is a question that is asked in this catalogue forward, okay? What happened? Что случилось? How is it that for decades the name of our greatest creators have disappeared into nothingness? So how is it that we only started to know about Bogomazov in 1991? How could it be that an extraordinary and multi-talented personality was presented as a deception and a mistake? So when Bogomazov died in 1930, from then on he was a formalist. He was banned by the regime. He was a non-artist. He did not exist. These sentences are really very important when looking to recreate the personality of this artist on a Western stage. How is it that Bogomazov, who was one of the greatest artists of his time, it sounds like hyperbole, but I hope that what I'll say will convince you that it is the case, was excluded from the artistic protest? That's written by Edward Dimschutz, who's a very good buddy of mine, who wrote the foreword to the 1991 catalogue and is a major Bogomazov scholar. How is it that the world forgot this extraordinary painter? Perhaps now the time has come. These are Edward's words. Perhaps now the time has come to recognize this artist for the genius that he unquestionably is. Right, so Bogomazov on the right, self-portrait from 1914, Graninfag on the left. The history of modern-day Ukraine and the history of Bogomazov is one and the same because it's one, I hate to say it, big tragedy. It's a story of suffering. It's a story of hopelessness. But at the end of it, there is some hope. Okay, so revolution, industrial progress. So I'm doing this chronologically. So revolution, we're talking 1905. Industrial progress, civil war, famine, illness, and pestilence. Brief regeneration. So the 1920s, Soviet Russia, there was a brief regeneration, there was brief artistic freedom. Then we had repression, courtesy of the Soviets. Then we had the Nazi invasion. And now, on the present day, we're experiencing a brief period of regeneration. However, within this chaos is a creative and able nation. This is the nation, this is the PR job that we've all got to do when presenting Ukraine on the national stage. Let's deal with revolution. Right, there are very many, many famous Ukrainian artists or Ukrainian-born artists, Malevich, Ekster, and Archipenko. Archipenko, who is known in the West as Archipenko, famous sculptor, was Bogomazov's best friend. And in 1905, during the February Revolution, they were both expelled from the Academy of Arts in Kiev for anti-Tsarist propaganda. But Bogomazov became the diarist of industrial progress. So many of you, I'm sure, know that the first one in Eastern Europe was here in Kiev. The second one in Europe, was built here in Kiev. So Kiev was, relatively speaking, a progressive nation. Now this is Bogomazov painting a locomotive, a train, a railway train, speeding forward towards you in 1914. With Bogomazov, it's very important to put everything into context. We have here another locomotive on the left. We have another locomotive on the right. These are industrial images. What Bogomazov is trying to convey here is movement, is dynamism, is excitement. He is a man to whom industry is of interest. This astonishing picture is called Montur in Russian. I haven't the faintest idea what it is in English. Electrician or electrical fitter. This is a pretty unique image anywhere in world art in 1915. This is his signature picture. This is Bogomazov's great, great work, Tramway Lvovskaya Ulitsa. So it's in Kiev, because Bogomazov's probably the greatest artist who showed Kiev, sadly not to the world. That's what we have to do. We've got to get Bogomazov to show his Kiev to the world, to show A, how beautiful Kiev is, how sophisticated Kiev is, and what a brilliant artist Bogomazov is. This picture, which is about this high and that wide, is in a private collection in Moscow. My friend Valery Dudakov is the owner. This is his meisterwork. It's his greatest picture, Tramway from 1914. This is a very sophisticated picture for that particular date. Now, as with all great artists, there is a love story involved in Bogomazov, and it's an incredibly touching love story, and it's an incredibly important love story, because in 1908, Bogomazov met a fellow student called Vanda, Vanda Monastirska. Vanda was completely appalled by this young man. He fell madly in love with her in 1908, at first meeting. And I've spoken to members of the family, and they've told very touching stories about how Bogomazov would literally hide behind a tree outside the Academy of Arts, wait for Wanda to come out, and then sort of burst out upon her with enormous surprise. Oh, goodness me, what a coincidence to meet you here. And gradually, slowly but surely, he won her over. And that showed a development in his art, because that's Wanda in 1908, just after she's met Bogomazov. All right. It's a kind of modest, it's a beautiful pointillist picture. It's in Kiev, by the way, and it's a modest picture. But by 1915, boom, that's the wonder that he sees, because he's now so confident in himself and in his feelings that he develops from that, through that, to that. Because 1908, they meet. 1913, they get married in August in Buerker, a village well known to our friend Mr. Kapik over there, and they get married in Buerker. And by 1915, Bogomazov is representing his wife in this extraordinary way, a la Picasso. So Picasso very seldom showed his women in a particularly positive light. Bogomazov's doing the same, not because he doesn't love Wanda, because he's become so creative an artist, so dynamic an artist, that he feels confident enough to do this pretty strashny portrait of his wife. Now, I like this. I found this very sort of touching, is because these are two pictures that I showed at TFAF Maastricht. We had seven portraits of... We had seven portraits of Wonder. I feel like a rock star with all these microphones. Now, this is Wonder in 1911. This is Wonder also in 1911. Now, what you're seeing here is a woman who's looking with suspicion at the person who's drawing her. So she's quite withdrawn. She's not showing herself to him. But, kaboom, explosion, marriage. That brought forward it. I can assure you marriage doesn't always work like that. But with Bogomazov, it did. This created within him an explosion of creative energy. Now, I love these words. They wrote such beautiful letters to one another. How I long to tell you that you are not a mere mortal in the world of art, writes Wonder to Bogomazov. Now, these are three portraits that I showed at TFAF Maastricht a month ago. And I think they're wonderful. They're so touching. They're so confident. They show various styles. That's clearly a much more avant-garde representation, but that, it's, I hate to use the words, but it's really quite a sexy drawing. She's clearly, they're very confident with one another, and Wonder, within time, fell, as can be seen by those words, madly in love with Bogomazov. So they had this sort of extraordinary love affair. I want to embrace you like the quiet before a sudden gust of wind. I mean, I don't want to be a victim of hyperbole, but I think those are the most beautiful words that a man can say to a woman, but that was what Wanda did to Bogomazov. And there we have it again. That's a 1908 watercolor in the museum in Kiev, and that's a drawing from 1915. So you can see again the development. Now, I do apologize to our distinguished guests from England, but there's this marvelous satirical poem from 1916. Obshchi fon yochinchi smnogi Mazov, vot vam tsirkulik ubist Mr. Bogomazov. These were verses written in 1916. I think the most important thing, of course, is the last four lines. Вот портрет жены. Поэт скрикнул, что за мода? Ведь такой жены портрет повод для развода. So we've got this, and it actually refers, sorry, what that means is that a Kiev poet wrote a satirical verse saying that a portrait like this must be a reason for getting divorced. Okay, now, in August 1914, Bogomazov started to put his artistic theories onto paper. He wrote a book called Painting and Elements. It's here in Kiev, it's in the archives of literature. And it involved these very complex geometric designs. And what Bogomazov sought to do was to work out the reaction between the viewer and the artist, so how a particular image could influence a particular emotional response in a human. It's a very complicated theory. I have to say it's not the most exciting read of all time, but it involves some very revolutionary thinking. The black square is the purest art form, says Bogomazov in August 1914. In 1915, Malevich paints black square. Now, I'm not suggesting that Malevich took any inspiration from Bogomazov, but it is worth pointing out that before Malevich painted black square, Bogomazov's already talking about it in his writings and in his theories. He is a revolutionary. Okay, now, I want to show you a few views of Kiev, because I do think they're wonderful. 1913, view of the city. 1914, the bazaar in Kiev, it's still there. On the left, it's Gluboshitsa. We all know Gluboshitsa. That's what it looked like in 1914, but through Bogomazov's eyes, it's a series of dynamic movement. It's almost vicious in its movement. These diagonals, these bizarre colors, the distortion of the buildings. If this was by a Russian artist, we'd all be going, oh, what a genius, because it's as good as the work of Rozanova, for example. Now, Rozanova is a top 10 Russian avant-gardist. She died very early, so there's very little work around, but this is easily the equal, and again, I'm going to go back to that point. Bogomazov never traveled. He sat in Kiev. He only knew about Western tendencies, Russian tendencies in art, through publications. On the right, it's called Prison. It's actually a brilliant, brilliant image. It's now in the collection of the Arsenal in Kiev. It used to be in the collection of Igor Tichenko. That prison, by the way, it's still there. But again, you've got these diagonals, you've got these bright colors, you've got this extraordinary distortion of the image. I love these two drawings. It's Khrushchev. All right, this is 1914. He's drawing Khrushchev like this. It's a great funnel of energy. Do you see? It's people walking down a street, but that's how Bogomazov views it. To him, it's the movement, it's the dynamic that really gets him going. Both of these were at some point in my collection, but more about that a little later. Has the time come? Do you remember what Edward Lumshitz said earlier on? Has the time come for recognition of this artist? Because between 1915 and 1916, Bogomazov becomes a world-class artist. This was set off by a trip to the Caucasus. He was permanently broke. He had to take a teaching job in Armenia. So off he went to Armenia, and he started painting things like this. Now, wherever possible, I've put the oil and the study for the oil on the left-hand side. I just think it makes it slightly more interesting. This used to be in my collection. It's now in a fantastically good collection in Switzerland. And this is what? It is an Armenian woman. Now, you can see the medals. There comes the plait out of her head. It is a completely unique representation of what an Armenian woman looks like. It's done in a sort of semi-geometric way. The color scheme is completely unique. I know of no artist in the West at the time who was painting like this. This picture is in the collection of Konstantin Grigoryushin in Moscow. It is a unique representation. Now, at the time, as I said, Bogomazov was in Armenia. This is called Воспоминания Кавказ, Reminiscences of the Caucasus. The drawing on the left, formerly my collection, and on the right, the oil that relates to this. It's this sort of crazy dynamism, movement, but it's all carefully thought out. It's a mathematical picture. It contains a lot of mathematical symbols. But at the top of it, you've got the clouds. You've got the calm before the storm, and it's full of this extraordinary imagery. These are Caucasus, both of them. They're ones in Nice. This one is currently hanging up in my gallery in London. Now, I showed this picture at TFAF Maastricht. Now, TFAF Maastricht is, as Valerie correctly said, an incredibly sophisticated art fair. And this picture was picked up on by so many people, and people looked at it and went, impossible. Well, it isn't impossible, it's incredibly possible. It's actually, I know it's a landscape, I know it's an abstract landscape, but goodness me, it's full of light, it's full of rhythm, it's full of dynamism, it's full of color, it's an astonishing image. Now, in 1916, Bogomazov came back to the little house on Voznesensky Spusk, and he started drawing things like this. Okay, this is called Fire in Kiev. It's in the Museum of National Art in Kiev. It is a monumentally brilliant representation of movement. Okay, it's a fire, but it's very difficult to imagine anybody painting a fire in such an effective and dynamic way. Now, in order to back up my absurd claims to the genius of Bogomazov, I'm going to show you artists painting at the same time with whom he's compared. Franz Marc Tiger on the left, 1913. I'm going to put all these in context. That drawing is 1916. On the right, that's Kandinsky's Red Square. Now, Bogomazov never saw these artists physically. He did see Kandinsky probably in 1910 in Odessa, but he never saw anything like that by Kandinsky. Giacomo Balla, the Italian futurists. Now, quite a strange thing happened when I first showed Bogomazov in the West, is people came up to me and went, "Ta, it's just a copier of Balla," until they saw the date. And they realized that actually he isn't copying Balla at all. He's actually creating his own image. I think Balla is a brilliant artist. He's Italian futurist. And again, like Bogomazov, his shtick is movement. He wants to show movement, dynamism on a canvas. There are two examples of Balla's work. Then we go on to another of the great Italian futurist, Severini, Woman in Blue on the left from 1912, Lancers from 1914-15 at the same time. Now, this is Boccioni, again an Italian futurist. Now, I don't know how similar this is to Bogomazov, but I don't think it is that similar. I think their only similarity is they're all seeking to do the same thing, which is create dynamism, create movement, but they're doing it in different ways. Now that is a very important Boccioni sculpture to which we will come later. This is Bogomazov at the same time. Okay? Locomotive from 1913, Street in Kiev from 1914 on the right. These are different images. These are futurist images, but they're in a different language. Now, we've still got the same movement that we had in Severini, but it's different. Right, now, if we compare and contrast that ghastly term, we have a locomotive on the left by Severini from 1914. And on the right, we've got Bogomazov's locomotive from 1914. They're not, actually, they're very, very different. The only time they're similar is that's in my collection, Landscape Locomotive from 1914, Severini's Landscape Locomotive from 1915. Bogomazov painted this a year before that. So he never saw that. He's not influenced by that particular picture. But I think this is an incredibly interesting representation of the revolutionary nature of this artist. What you have here is the blue. It represents the locomotive coming towards you. That's the lamps coming out of the front of it, the smoke, the billowing, the movement. It's the same theme as Severini, but it's painted in a completely different way. Now, by 1917, Giacomo Balla, who we saw slightly earlier, is painting flat, in my opinion, slightly dreary work. Bogomazov, on the other hand, he's painting really creatively. He's painting dynamically. Now, if you look at the color in that picture and you think of the color of Kiev churches, and Bogomazov actually wrote about this, how he was influenced by the color of Kiev churches, I think you can see that it's very difficult to imagine Blue Bouquet, which is in my collection, with without having lived so long in Kiev and seen the Baroque of Kiev, seen the blue of Kiev, seen the golden cupolas of Kiev. Okay, now by 1917, we got Severini on the right from 1917, Bogomazov on the left. Now, in 1917, Bogomazov gave up painting. This is probably his last picture. It is a phenomenally confident, brilliant, and accomplished work of art. It is no worse than the rest, the one on your right, but at the same time, it's speaking its own language. Now, this is, if you like, the apogee of Bogomazov. This is the moment when he is truly, in my extremely unhumble opinion, a brilliant, brilliant, world-class Ukrainian painter. I'm going to remind you again. This is a man creating that who has only been there. He's never been to Berlin. He's never been to Paris. He's never been to Milan, the center of Italian futurism. He's just had a few magazines brought to him by Exter as his inspiration. He hasn't traveled at all. And then he stops painting because the history of Bogomazov is the history of the Ukraine. As an artist, Bogomazov remained silent until 1926. Now, the reasons for this are legion. They are connected with history. They're connected with the history of Ukraine. We had the charming 1917 revolution. We had war. We had famine. We had civil war, which, as we all know, in Kiev was particularly savage when, between 1918 and 1921, I think there was something like 18 changes of government. It was utter chaos, and in this chaos, Bogomazov was living. This is Wanda's father, Witold. Okay, there's Wanda's here. But Bogomazov was extremely fond of his father-in-law. And between 1917 and 1926, Bogomazov painted two pictures, Catafalque and Funeral. Now, he painted these pictures as a reaction to the death of his father-in-law in 1920. And it's this story of hopeless misery that Bogomazov made the coffin, he painted the coffin, he buried his own father-in-law. The tragedy actually continued for another 10 years because they then lost the location of the grave. It was only in 1929, I think, where they found the location again. So these are the only two events. These are two events that inspired Bogomazov to paint these extraordinarily powerful images. That is hanging up in the Museum of Ukrainian Art in Kyiv. It's tiny, it's that. But according to Simon Hewitt, who wrote the catalogue of Bogomazov, boom, boom, with me, it is one of the most harrowing images of Christian burial ever conceived. Now, I think that is a very harrowing means desperate, tortuous, memorable. And I have to say, I agree with it. These crosses all at angles with one another. It's stronger than anything any German painted at the same time, but it's there. It's your picture. It's a Ukrainian picture. It's a moment of extraordinary inspiration in a very inspiring nation which needs to create itself again. Now, of ironies, in 1920, Bogomazov, who was working on agitprop at the time, he was working on the steamship, the Pushkin, caught tuberculosis. And just to stick the knife in just a little more, I'm going to read the reminiscences of his daughter at the time. The irony of irony, Bogomazov himself then fell victim to this illness. "That was a fateful time," remembers his daughter, Yaroslava. "My father contracted tuberculosis. I remember one day when my mother and a friend of ours, Nikolai Nidzvetsky, a piano teacher at the Kiev Conservatory, were talking in hushed tones and running hither and thither. My father was missing. This was the day he fell seriously ill. He was delirious with a high temperature and spent the whole day wandering around. He was only found late at night next to a church. Later, we found out that this was the day that he received his diagnosis, his sentence, tuberculosis of the lungs." So this was the final irony, that this great creative man fell ill from tuberculosis. Now, the years 1920 to 1930 are the end of Bogomazov's career. He is under a death sentence. There is no cure, despite the optimistic nature of this poster. There is no cure for tuberculosis, especially not in 1920. But there's a brief regeneration. He became teacher at the Kiev Institute of Art. He became professor of easel painting. Now, this gave him, if you like, this is the original, the family gave me this document. This is the original, you can see, 14th of, I think it's February, but it's written in Ukrainian, 1922. Confirming that Bogomazov is now a professor at the Kiev Institute. There's the Kiev Institute, and Bogomazov is extreme right looking at the camera with his students. There he is again. He's the gentleman out of focus. On the right is Mikhail Boychuk. Center is Karamadyanka, who was a distinguished artist at the Academy at the time. This is what Bogomazov has taken up as his career. But in 1926, he comes back to painting. Now, I don't know the exact reason why he came back to painting, but I think he wanted to leave a legacy. I think he wanted to say something completely new and to leave something to which future generations would look and hold on to. Now, these are, he painted only two oils that I know of. One is portrait of his daughter Yaroslava, who was born in 1917, which is this extraordinary futurist, crazy spectralist picture done in three primary colors. Again, I don't know anybody who's painting like that at the time. And this is Sawdust Carriers. This is Bogomazov's last oil from 1928-29. Now, that study is in the Guggenheim Museum. So, fortunately, Bogomazov is represented in some collections, but this is a terrible picture. This is not the happy Soviet future. This is a story of drudgery, of toil, of hardship. Painting at the time, you may or may not know, had to be optimistic. It had to promote the regime. It had to say that all was going to be great in the happy Soviet future. That is not a happy picture. But what Bogomazov concentrated on more than anything was Pilshiki, the Sawyers. Now, I hope, and if you haven't seen this picture, you should be heartily ashamed. This picture is hanging up in the Museum of National Art in Kiev. It's in the permanent collection. It is permanently on display in the museum. And this is painted in 1928. Now, irony of ironies, there's another painting called Sawyers from 1929. And this is the condition that this picture is in. Now, this is a terrible, again, story because it's irony. This picture was taken by the Nazis, and it was stored in Nazi Germany and brought back to Soviet Russia in that condition in 1947. This picture was not taken by the Nazis, and it was left to rot in the reserve collections. Bogomazov, the non-artist, the banned artist. Therefore, nobody saw this picture. It's still in that condition. I have offered the museum to restore this picture at my expense in the West. And believe you me, it is not an easy task to persuade them to let me have that picture for the 1 year that it needs to be properly restored. Now, in relation to this picture, Bogomazov did hundreds and hundreds of studies. Okay, there they are. You can see some of the figures that you recognize from the previous pictures. These are all in the Museum of Arkansas. You wouldn't believe it was possible, but they're in Little Rock, Arkansas. Part of the research that I'm doing into this artist, that I'm finding where every single work by Bogomazov is, these are in Arkansas. We reproduced them for the first time in the catalog. Okay, these are all in my collection. Now, you can see these all relate to particular parts of the Sawyer's work. So, for example, the feet there are shown on the far right. So all these are studies to particular figures. Now, in amongst the hundreds of drawings that Bogomazov did are these, which seem to have no relation whatsoever to the two pictures of Sawyer's that we saw. And nobody really knew why until very, very recently, Yelena Kashuba brilliantly discovered that we have three studies which culminate in this color, watercolor, which is in my collection. She worked out that we have on our hands a 20th century altarpiece. This is what Bogomazov was trying to do, a triptych in Soviet Russia, an altarpiece, this astonishing three pictures all together. When they're all together, they make sense. Now, one of the things that I'm desperately trying to do is get that restored, get a copy painted of that by a competent student in the same style as these two works here, hang them together. And then you can actually see what Bogomazov was trying to get to. Now, Bogomazov was an atheist, but his dying words were, "God exists, just don't tell anybody." Now, when somebody dies, their psychology, or is dying, their psychology changes markedly. So Bogomazov knew he was dying. Therefore, he could paint this triptych without any fear of repression, because he knew perfectly well that whatever happened, he was going to die anyway. So you have this almost biblical picture. It's seen from different angles. That's from above, that's from below, that's close in. It's like a sort of cinema picture. But I think, bizarrely, that this is such a brilliant work that when it, if it's restored to its glory, that the glory that the artist intended, we have on our hands a symbol of Ukraine, a future symbol of this country. Let's talk about repression. It's a favorite of our friends, the Soviets. They do it so brilliantly. Now, Boychuk, repressed, shot, because he was a revolutionary artist. This is Bogomazov was lucky to die in 1930. Had he not died, they would have shot him anyway. Now, Wanda kept all his pictures in a massive trunk. That's where Bogomazov's work lay, forgotten, between 1932 and 1966, when there was the first exhibition here in Kiev. That's 34 years of no one seeing them. They just sat in a trunk. Then along came the Nazis, and Voznesensky Spusk was in the zone of occupation. So what did Wanda do? She put the trunk on a wagon, and she pushed that wagon out of Kiev to Svitushina, which is, I believe, about 20 kilometers outside Kiev, where she hid it with relatives. She then came back to Kiev in 1944 with the same trunk on the same wagon, and brought it back to the flat. So again, let's go back to that love story. Wanda saved Bogomazov's entire oeuvre from the Nazis by wheeling it out of Kiev, and when the Nazis left, going out and getting it and wheeling it all back again. As an artist, silence until 1966, when he was discovered by Alexander Parnas, Dmitry Gorbachev. Parnas lives in Moscow, Gorbachev, the lovely gentleman, lives in Kiev. They discovered the artist. But then we have silence again. This artist does not exist because, for example, Gorbachev was sacked from his job at the Museum of Ukrainian Art because of his open support for this great revolutionary artist, Bogomazov. He didn't come to surface again until 1991. Now, in the West, this was slightly different. The first time we heard about Bogomazov, 1974, Taplin's Dream, Fisher Fine Art. We then had 100 years of Russian art at the Barbican in 1988. Then we had the Toulouse exhibition. Then we had the exhibition here in Kiev. And on the far right was the last personal exhibition of Bogomazov at the Russian Museum in, what's it called, St. Petersburg. Now, it is a matter of no shame for me to tell you that the Pushkin Museum have offered to do a personal exhibition of Bogomazov. Now, art can actually transcend the barriers of politics. So the director of the Pushkin Museum, Marina Lashak, is a friend of mine. She said, let's do the Bogomazov exhibition, because she's not looking at it from a political angle, she's looking at it from an artistic angle. That's how good Bogomazov is and could be. Now, let's talk about Bogomazov in the present day. These were the last two exhibitions that I did. That's Bogomazov Soyuz on the front, TFAF 2015, TFAF 2016. I produced this extremely large book with Wanda on the front. Now, we're talking about cultural diplomacy in action. How can culture help form a national identity? Well, here we have four drawings from my collection, which were at TFAF 2015. Locomotive, Forest Boyerka, Krishatik, and Tramway Lvovska Ulitsa, so Lvovska Street. In Holland, there's a very sophisticated museum, and it's called the Kroller Müller Museum. It's an absolutely brilliant museum in a park in the middle of nowhere near Utrecht in Holland. They now own all four of those Bogomazovs. So the director of the museum, a charming lady called Lisette Pelsers, came to my stand in TFAF, took one look at these and went, oh my God, this guy is brilliant. A major sophisticated museum has recognized this artist for what he is. Now, that grinning idiot there is standing next to 1, 2, 3, 4 Bogomazovs. Now, suddenly Bogomazov's on the international stage. He's in a serious museum collection, and he's not hidden away in the reserve collection. He's on the wall. People are seeing him. Now, one of the reasons that that grinning idiot was standing there is because there's Baccioni's sculpture. So this is a monument to world futurism by Baccioni, the Italian futurist. And next to it, in the same room, are hanging four works by the greatest Ukrainian artist ever. Might be worth pointing out what else the Kroller Müller Museum has in their collection. Anybody knows, everybody knows, that those two pictures are by Van Gogh. Everybody knows that Sura. Everybody knows that those Van Goghs too. The Van Gogh Gallery, the Kroller Müller Museum, is Vincent Van Gogh's second home with almost 90 paintings and over 180 drawings. The museum has the second largest Van Gogh collection in the world. It's got an astonishing collection. It's a major, major museum. And in the next door hall to Van Gogh is hanging Bogomazov. That collection is now six Bogomazovs, because at TFAF 2016, the museum came and bought another two works by Bogomazov. He's now international. He's becoming more international. Looks like a football score. Van Gogh 260, Bogomazov 6. But my goodness me, what a start. What a fantastic start that we have this brilliant Ukrainian artist represented in such a sophisticated Western collection, because Kroller Müller has 260 works by Van Gogh. Whoa! By Van Gogh. Also, I should point out that courtesy of TFAF, courtesy of being a dealer in Bogomazov, we now have Bogomazovs in very sophisticated collections in England, Holland, three different locations, Austria, Munich, Zurich, Geneva. Now, people are quite cynical about work being sold to private individuals. I'm extremely positive about it because there are two things to remember. Every single new owner of Bogomazov is more than happy to let these pictures come to Kiev for an exhibition. This is incredibly important. One of them, who will be remain anonymous, is a gentleman who has even mentioned help with sponsorship for this particular exhibition. We're beginning to move this artist forward, as he deserves to be, with the help of sophisticated private collectors in the West. The next phase. Right, we've talked about the triptych, we've talked about this magnificent monument to Ukrainian art, how that must be restored. I don't know how on earth I'm ever going to persuade the museum to give me that picture so I can give it to sophisticated Western restorers and bring it back to Kiev in the condition in which it's meant to be. But I believe the creation of this extraordinary biblical triptych, I mean, I think they might even be carving, cutting the cross. That's how religious an image this is. We need to restore this to its original glory. Next up, the catalogue raisonné. Now, I am busy doing the catalogue raisonné. At present, I have money from three different sources. We have enough money now to do the catalogue raisonné. This is vitally important. A catalogue raisonné means that every single picture by Bogomazov will be recorded in a book. This book will then be given to people. People will read about him. People will understand about him. And with that will become the next phase, which is personal exhibitions. This artist needs to be shown on a world stage. Now, at present, the Museum of Ukrainian Art, I'm going to see them in 2 hours, we're going to be discussing how we're going to put the exhibition, personal exhibition of Bogomazov on in the Museum of Ukrainian Art in Kiev. That is for the end of this year. But on the back of this exhibition, the Museum of Ukrainian Art in New York want to do an exhibition in 2017. So gradually, this wheel is beginning to turn, and people are beginning to recognize that maybe the time has come for Bogomazov to become the great Ukrainian representative, your representative in the West. Thank you very much for listening. Any questions?
James, thank you very much. Dear students, you can give the questions to our lecturer, to our friend, I can tell. Please.
As you see, this is an extremely good question. Thank you very much. First of all, it's the belief of Simon Hewitt, who wrote a brilliant article for this catalogue, that this is a religious image. And Simon has convinced me that it's a religious image. Now, I don't have enough concrete evidence to tell you that it's a religious image, because unfortunately we need to study the archives. Now, the archives are here in Kiev. One of the things that a catalogue raisonné does is it studies the archives, and maybe there we'll find what we need to find regarding Bogomazov's thinking at the time. We know that he turned to God, if you like, by his death, because he said God exists, just don't tell anybody on his deathbed. So it's difficult to say whether or not it's religious, but as a triptych, I don't think I know very many triptychs of the 20th century, especially in Soviet Russia between 1928 and 1929, when this is painted. Now, you could only see a triptych as a biblical entity. So therefore, the very notion of a triptych is religious in itself. So that's why I think we have on our hands potentially a religious image open to interpretation. Yeah. Yeah, I think that's part of it. I think that Bogomazov, first of all, he'd become, though these were sold, incidentally, to the Museum of Ukrainian Art at the time. He never got paid for the one in the middle. He was permanently fighting them over 750 rubles that they owed him. But I think do you remember the sawdust carriers, the two old people carrying the sawdust? I think that's a pretty sad picture, but it's a very spiritual picture. And I think that the answer to your question is that Bogomaz was a deeply spiritual man. If you read his letters to Wanda, for example, they're incredibly touching representations of the very depths of emotion. So I think he probably turned to God, as it were, as do many people, in the last months of his life. But I think this is something to do with it. I think this is a puzzle that needs further research. Thanks for your question. Sorry, gentlemen there.
I was wondering whether this Western European contact that you mentioned, primarily with the reference to the Italian futurism, would it make sense to compare him to what was going on in England at that time? What I'm saying is that, you know, Wyndham Lewis, when you saw a couple of pictures of the electrician, the fitter, I thought that was William, Wyndham Lewis.
Yeah.
And, you know, the blast that the magazine at that time, that would make sense to me, I think. What do you think?
Yeah, well, funnily enough, you clearly know your art very well, because I think there's a lot of Wyndham Lewis and Nevinson as well. These are British war artists. They're vorticists. And funnily enough, the word vorticist has been applied to Bogomazov. Now, this is a very bizarre coincidence, is, of course, Bogomazov never saw Wyndham Lewis. He never saw Nevinson. But I have very, very good friends in London called Osborne Samuel, who are dealers in Nevinson, Wyndham Lewis, Power, and others. So the British artists of the 1910s and the 1920s. Now, Osborne Samuel, when they saw my collection of Bogomazov, they went, we've got to do an exhibition with Nevinson, Wyndham Lewis, and so on. So you're jumping the gun, because I agree with you. I think that'd be a fascinating exhibition. I think the important thing to do now is to actually promote solely Bogomazov, and then I think all those sort of branch exhibitions can happen later. Very, very perceptive. Gentleman there wanted to ask something. The question is in the answer's in the question. It's because there's too much bureaucracy. Now, I do understand that there's too much bureaucracy, but what I did make clear when I made my offer was I wasn't paying any bribes to anybody. You want that picture restored properly by top museum people? Give it to me, and I'll do it. That's my promise. Okay? I don't want any monkey business that's attached with it. Sorry. So, very good question. It isn't the museum's fault. The museum have been incredibly positive and incredibly helpful. I mean, in my catalogue, you know, I mentioned to the previous director of the Museum of Kiev Art, of Ukrainian Art in Kiev, Masha Zadorozhna, and I also mentioned Yulia Litvinets, who have been unbelievably helpful and would give me this picture to get restored properly tomorrow if they could. They just know what's higher up the tree. And what's higher up the tree is, God help us, bureaucracy. And no, nope, I'm not getting involved. Yeah, but the offer's still there. If anyone can help me, hey, I'm ready to do it. Sure. I wish I knew the answer, because I don't think there are too many representations of sawyers in the late 1920s. It's normally factory workers. You know, it's the glorious future. Why has he chosen sawyers? Funnily enough, there's in my catalogue, which is online, by the way, there's a lovely little piece describing how his daughter, in her reminiscences, walked with her father through the forests in Buerker to actually see the sawyers at work. There was a documentary film done of it in Ukraine, in Kyiv, in 2003, 2004, I think. So I wish I knew the answer, but I think it's maybe to do with the religious element, maybe. Thanks. Ah, Kirill. I warned our distinguished guests before we started that some of the questions would be extremely difficult. That's one of them. I don't think I know the answer. I think the trouble with artists is they're very particular people with a very particular mentality. And I think they see their... I think Bogomazov saw himself as a genius. Of that I'm fairly convinced. And the reason I'm convinced of that is because his technique as a painter and how it developed. So from painting these extraordinary abstract pictures, he's now painting realism, but he's painting realism in a very unusual way. This is you could say this is a Fauvist picture in its use of color. But if you actually look closely at the pictures, if you look at it closely hanging up in the museum, apart from the fact that it's not in very good condition, it's quite interesting the way he's painted it. It's a sort of, it's like a Renaissance picture painted in a sort of abstract, constructivist way. It's a very, very clever work of art. So I don't know how Bogomazov saw himself, because I think Bogomazov was pretty prescient. I think he knew that had he not died, he would be repressed, like Bujuk was and like the Bujukisti were. I think he knew that. I think that was in his. I think that was in his psyche because he'd, if you liked, turned to God in his last few months. Now he certainly couldn't do that publicly. So I think Bogomazov would be extremely pleased at the way we are now perceiving him. If that's an answer to your question. Anybody else? Again, extremely good question. Thank you very much. The answer is no, he didn't inspire people because nobody actually saw it. You know, as a teacher, Bogomazov was important. Bogomazov further to painting and elements, he did a series of color theories and how the human eye reacts to color. And again, it's a very advanced, very deep thinking document. There was an artist of the Soviet underground called Alexander Tushler. Tushler died in 1980, but he was a pretty famous underground artist. Now, he was Bogomazov's pupil. And when you have complete silence about an artist from 1932, basically till 1991, he can't influence anybody because nobody's looking at it, nobody sees it. I think the 1966 exhibition, we talked, remember, the Ukrainian Picasso, 1966 by Anatoly Sumar. I think that exhibition was important. I think it did have an influence on young artists, but it didn't have the influence it should have had. Now, why I think it's so important to show Bogomazov in his entirety, especially here in Kyiv, is because I think young artists will become inspired, because I think they'll look at this extraordinary artist. You talked to yourself about the incredible use of color. And they'll look at it and go, goodness me, this is our artist. This is our Ukrainian artist. This isn't, forgive me for saying so, Primachenka and Katya Bilakur. This is Bogomazov. He's uniquely Ukrainian, but he's Western-leaning. And I think that that is, if you like, the history of, it's the story of Ukraine today. It is cut down the middle, and it's leaning towards the West. And I think that that's why Bogomazov himself is actually the ideal artist to represent this country. Thank you for your question. Well, we can call him whatever you like. We can call him the Ukrainian Bala. We can call him the Ukrainian Bochonu. We can call him the Ukrainian. We, you know, I mean, it's. I think I'm sure you understand. The words Ukrainian Picasso is just is, if you like, a label on which to hang this particular name. I don't. Of course, Bogomazov did not have the same influence on art that Picasso had. Picasso had the greatest influence on 20th century art. If you want to call him the Ukrainian Modigliani, you can, because of the tragic nature of Bogomazov's life. But you know, Modigliani died extremely young, which you know Bogomazov didn't. Bogomazov was only active from 1906 to 1917, which is 11 years, and another four at the end of his career. So he's active only for 16 years. So that's less than, that's more than Modigliani. But I think where the only similarity I can draw is the tragic nature of both of their lives. In the case of Modigliani, of course, he was not as monogamous as Bogomazov was. Bogomazov was madly in love with Wanda all his life. And Wanda was madly in love with him. It's a beautiful story. I wish that we could, you know, this is why to me this catalogue resume is so important, is because I'd love to see published the love letters between the two, because they are things of enormous beauty, because of course, like most artists, Bogomazov had other talents. He was a very good musician and a very good poet. So it's, I think it's a label to hang him on. I think it's better to describe him as the Ukrainian Bala, so the great futurist, the poet of the new industrial age. I think that's probably the best way to describe him. Any other questions? Oh, gentlemen again. Yeah, that's a very good question. Funny enough, you need to come to my Lex lecture, and then you'll hear all about the mass faking of Russian art. You always have problems with authenticity when you're dealing with any art from Eastern Europe. And the one of the things that I'm doing is I'm setting up a thing called the Komitet Bogomazova. And that will consist of myself, Edward Tumshitz, the professor who I mentioned early, and Tanya Popova, who is Bogomazov's granddaughter. So we'll be, there's a very well-known committee of Chagall in the West, and if the committee of Chagall says it's not by Chagall, it's not by Chagall. And our committee will be pretty much the same. I mean, people do show me pictures by Bogomazov. I was shown one on Sunday, which simply isn't by Bogomazov. Now, it's my word against their word. I've been dealing with Bogomazov since 1988. So it's a very good question. You need to come to my next lecture. Very good question, thank you. Well, I first saw Bogomazov in 1988 at the Barbican. So in London they did an exhibition called 100 Years of Russian Art from Private Collections. Okay, and there were four Bogomazovs, including Tramway, Lvovska ulitsa, and Paravoz, so locomotive. So I saw them, that was the first time I actually saw Bogomazov. And I have to say that Tramway was this extraordinary statement to me. I thought it was one of the most amazing pictures that I'd ever seen. I first bought a picture by Bogomazov in 1994, and it stayed with me until 2015 when I sold it to the Kroller Müller Museum. So it's such a lovely thing for me as a collector to see work that I've invested, you know, money, time, effort into going to a museum. And just to refresh your memory, that's Tramway. Okay, so that was 1988. That was the first time I saw it. So I first started dealing seriously with Bogomazov in 1994. And that's when I bought my first Bogomazov, which is now in the Kroller Müller. So thank you for your question. Anyone else?
Some more questions, please. It's all. James,
so?
We are very grateful for you and for your presentation, Brian's presentation. Really, I feel you more patriot of Ukraine than me, really. You see, it's very interesting for me personally. And I hope you don't forget Institute in the nearest future. And we are very glad to see you more. I know you have some more lectures, very interesting, like investition in arts. So it's I hope it will be very interesting for our students also. And I know you organize you want to organize an exhibition. You said about it in Kyiv in National Museum. If you need some help for us and for our students, you can be relied to it. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. И, кстати, следующая лекция будет на русском языке, поэтому у вас будет меньше проблем. Но я всегда удивляюсь вашим знанием английского языка. Это фантастика. Поздравляю вас. И ждем вас на следующей лекции. Следующая лекция называется «Провал бренда». Это вот относительно к вопросу молодого человека о полной фальсификации русского авангарда. То есть вот из 100 картин, которые мне привозят, ну, чуть не каждый месяц для проверки, 99 из них являются фальшивками. И об этом будет следующая лекция. Поэтому жду вас с нетерпением. Спасибо за внимание.